call away. I had to call her.
Right.
I'm gonna bring my dog next time.
We're working good for two.
Thing is, cause they had this.
It's more than.
Yeah, that's very fair. Anytime you need to get her run,
she's good.
She is. I like that. Yeah. But if you need one, Helen, you go ahead and get it.
Jesus. Everybody's got to sing extra loud. First one is God is so good, page 23. God is so good. All four verses, from what I hear. Don't have an accompaniment on that over there. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He's so good to me.
On three.
I love him so. I love him so. I love him so. He's so good to me.
On four.
I praise his name. I praise his name. I praise his name. He's so good to me.
Amen. All right, the next one's on page 581. We have heard the joyful sound. That's going to be the first, second, and last verse.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the seas and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing the islands of the sea. Echo back the ocean's cave. Earth shall hear her jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. On four. Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free. Highest hills and deepest caves. This our song. is on page 581.
That's all of it.
Is it, you make a, you didn't want to sing that up?
No.
Okay.
That's for the invitation. Well, that's actually for the invitation. So we'll go ahead and take special requests. Anybody has one you'd like to mention, feel free to do so. How's Bobby doing this evening, little mate?
That's what they were taking up. He's still about the same. It's real red and irritable. He said he feels like something's in there.
I bet he
and
does.
I'm a wolf, and she's doing the drops every 3 hours, and she said there's nothing in there. It's just real red and irritated.
Yeah.
And
that's just hard. I know that hurts. Tomorrow, so he said he wouldn't be there tonight.
Oh,
he's having a real good time, I'm sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That preparation is worse than procedure, isn't it?
Yeah.
But, I called him, talked to him in Irene, and said hello.
He'd had enough, didn't he?
He'd had enough.
He wasn't going to talk.
He wasn't going to talk.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. All right. Anybody else? Bob, Jackie, how about Bobby? How's she today?
Well, it seems like she's a little bit better today.
Good.
I'm glad to see her and all. And she just, we're talking on with her today. Mm-hmm. I don't know what might be the next time I go with her.
Yeah. Changes from time to time, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're glad she's feeling better today. Thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
That's wonderful. Deborah.
Update on Suzette. She is in rehab. She's doing good. Hopefully they'll keep her there and let her do extensive rehab. Don Smith, I'm from the hospital. I talked to last time. Out working on his tractor this evening. So
okay.
God has really touched him in a powerful way.
Yeah.
And the Medley family, they lost Beverly.
Okay.
And just, you know, pray for them for salvation.
All right.
And of course, lost in all of our.
Oh, yes. Keep the lost in our prayers. That's for sure. All right. Anybody else want to mention one tonight?
Never Shirley.
Shirley? I sure will, dear.
Keep her in prayers.
Right. How's your daughter doing, dear? She doing? How's your daughter doing out there?
Okay. She's doing fine. Last time I talked to her.
Good.
She said she's about done. She's going to roll over because it's 112 degrees that day. Out there.
112 out there.
She's in the oven, then, ain't you, girl?
They're living in an oven, aren't they? Out in Oklahoma.
Oklahoma, yeah.
That's a pretty hot place. Joe?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. She's not. Let's keep Maria in our prayers. I know she has a rough time from day to day, too, so pray for Marie. Also for Ruth, her sister. Keep all these in our prayers.
That was Mary Ann, the Shirley's sister.
She's. Yeah, that's Shirley's sister. Just talking about Shirley.
Oh, it was Shirley, not Mary, and I don't know nothing about her.
Oh, okay.
Oh, Scott, you mean?
Yeah.
We don't ever hear her speak from her.
Yeah.
She don't call Shirley?
She don't call Shirley, that for some reason she's turned into somewhat of a recluse.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, isn't that something?
Yeah, he was
out there. Yeah, he was
outside. Yeah, I sat out there.
The medication, they finally got a medication that was helping him with his heart, and he's doing a lot better than that. He's got to go back to work, and he got a birthday coming up Wednesday.
That's great. I'm glad Scott's doing better. He's always faithful. Billy was out there too, wasn't he? And Keith?
Yeah.
Yeah. Keith called. Wanda said she had a migraine this morning. She was out
Keith
there.
Hockey.
I mean, yeah, Keith Hockey. Yes, Keith Hockey. We need to pray for Keith Cole.
Yeah.
Lord will bring him back in. He needs to be up here singing. I told him, I said, you got a dial from the Lord.
Anybody else? How about unspoken? Unspoken?
Okay.
Yes. Go right ahead, Wilma. Situation to be in.
Yes, sir. So the families went through a lot. They didn't come down this year with us camping, and we've all, for the last 3 years, all camped together.
Right.
But, it's, yeah, it's been a rough week and a half for that family.
Okay.
And decisions to be made, and the father finally decided to do the chemo, and then the doctor said he would do chemo. And
okay. Yeah, when he says he's ready then, that's for sure. Yeah. Also, Mr. Bill Walker, he was out here this morning. Let's keep him in our prayers. He may be out there tonight. He always listens to both services. He's the one that had the lung transplant and doing pretty good right now. He's had some infections, some setbacks, but he got to take a trip not long ago up to see his family up north, his daughter, I believe it was, so pray for Bill Walker. God will touch him and heal him and strengthen him. Fine Christians, gentlemen. Okay, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Remember these. Jackie, you want to lead us in prayer tonight as we start our service?
Lord, we thank you for another beautiful day you've given us. Lord,
yes.
Thank you for watching over us and taking care of us, Lord. Father, we thank you for each and every one of you tonight, Lord. If there are people that don't know the leave, let them be tonight in the time that you come up. Stand behind us, sit at the desk, Lord. Just give me the word that teach us that one. Let us put it in our heart and our mind and take it out to this quarter, Lord. For this thing will be long before you come and take us all home, Lord.
Yes.
We're just waiting for your day, Lord. And I just give me time. I want to go right now.
Amen.
Yes, I will.
Yes.
Go with us down the way, just Lord. So we'll take us home safely.
Amen. Thank you so much, Jackie. I appreciate that prayer. Okay, a couple of announcements. Don't forget, we're reorganizing the choir. We have 10 now, so we're getting pretty close, Dan, to getting our choir going. And if you can make a joyful noise, that's all you need to do. Get up there and make a joyful noise and do the Lord. And also, don't forget the trip. We still have a few places left. That's coming up. It's August the 6th, I think. Isn't that right?
It's coming up Saturday.
This Saturday. Okay, so 9 o'clock. Those who are planning on going, we'll leave here, go down to Charlotte, enjoy a good drama. The feeding of the 5,000. I've always wanted to see that. We're going to get to see it. 5 loaves and 2 little fish. Turned that into a better than Libby Hill seafood or Mayflower. But it's going to be a good program. So if you'd like to go, sign up there in the back. Appreciate it. Willa May organizing that for us, and Randy's getting the bus ready, and so we're going to have a good time. Okay, I believe that's about all the different announcements. Jerry, if you want to come, Randy, if you want to come, we'll go ahead and see if our Wednesday night off for him.
Wednesday night.
I mean, our Sunday night. Let me get myself straightened up here. All right. That old timer's kicks in every once in a while. I'll tell you that right now.
As I do.
Jerry, you lead us, if you would.
Heavenly Father, come to you tonight in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you for another opportunity to be here this evening, Lord, in your house.
Yes.
Lord, just bring the Holy Spirit in here today. Just weave in and out of the pews and on the pulpit and put the Word of God in the pastor's mouth, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, let us be good. Let us take the message and apply it to our hearts and minds and take it out in this old cruel world. and do with it the praise, honor, and glory of your name. For I say in your name I ask. Amen.
This world looks upon me as I struggle along. They say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. 'Cause in my heart I'm rejoicing in how I wish they could see. Blessings on me. There's a roof up above me and a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Blessings on me. Been good to us, haven't it? Sent my little grandson when I was 70 years old to help me get on through. You know what I'm talking about. I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes are not new, and I don't have much money. Ain't got any. But Lord, I got you, and to me, that's all that matters, though the world may not see. hangs on me. There's a roof up above me and a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me a loved one and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Chapter number 4. We mentioned this morning, this is a prison epistle. Paul's writing from prison, but he's telling the people, hey, if I can rejoice, then you can rejoice. If I can, in this prison, have a joy in my heart, you can have a joy in your heart out there in the sunlight.
Yes.
Out there walking in freedom. And so, what a great passage this is, Philippians chapter number 4. Some great promises here. We won't get them all tonight, but I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. That's in this passage. We talked about this morning, we're going to look tonight at don't worry about anything, but learn to pray about everything. When you do that, he takes a lot of that worry away, and he replaces it with assurance. He replaces it with his power. So if you have your Bible, we'll pick it back up at verse number 1, Philippians chapter number 4. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and my crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Now, if you notice, he calls them dearly beloved twice. So he must have really had a special love for this church. He started the church. He planted the church. Now, he is so thankful that he did, because this is a fine church. They interacted with him several times, sent him offerings, checked up on him from time to time to see if they could help him. But then we saw this morning there was a problem that developed, and the problem is in verse number 2. I beseech Eutychus and I beseech Sympathy that they be of the same mind in the Lord. Be of the same mind, here's the idea of being in harmony. Be in unity. Don't let a rift, don't let some kind of a division creep into the church, because people were probably taking sides, one with this lady, one with that lady, and pretty soon it really affected the church, and Paul waits until the very last chapter to even bring it up. But he did bring it up because he wanted it straightened out, and apparently these two ladies were very good workers. I mean, they were successful Christian ladies that loved God and loved people, but they had some kind of a disagreement. We don't read about what the reaction was, but I just feel like that they probably made up and that they probably got right and had a good relationship after that, but it doesn't tell us. Then he says here, I need some help in doing this in verse number 3, and I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow. We don't know who yoke fellow is either. That might be Epaphroditus, old Pappy. He's one of their prominent men. He says, true yoke fellow, I want you to help me with these women who have labored with me in the gospel. And Clement, he's another man that he said, I want you to help me also, and with many other fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Aren't you glad that when you get saved, your name's in the book of life?
Yes.
Nobody can get it out. Signed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Woo, that's about enough to make me shout tonight. Amen. And verse number 4, rejoice in the Lord always. That's what he said. Your name's in the book of life. Rejoice, your sins are forgiven. Rejoice, you're going to heaven. Rejoice, he said. You've got Jesus who will never leave you nor forsake you, and he'll carry you when you can't walk. Thank God we can rejoice. But we rejoice not in the things of the world. We don't rejoice in what the world doth. We rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Yes. I've said it many times. As long as you've got the Lord, you've got all you really need. Because He's going to be by your side. Then he says in verse number 5, let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. That word carries the idea, hey, He may come at any time. His coming is imminent. That means nothing has to happen before He comes back. He may come tonight. He may come tomorrow. He may come next week. Who knows when He's coming? But when He comes, woo, we're out of here. He's going to say, come up hither. And we are going up. The dead in Christ arise first, and we who are alive and remain are caught up together with Him. So you can rejoice. Why? The Lord's at hand. Then he says in verse number 6, here's that prayer promise. Be careful for nothing. The Greek language, that carries the idea, don't worry about anything. Worry is like the rocking chair. It'll give you something to do, but it won't get you anywhere. You're working away, rocking back and forth, but you're sitting in the same place you were 30 minutes ago, huh? So he says here, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. Not known unto the priest, or not known to some confessional, you tell God about it. And God will wash you, and God will cleanse you. In 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And then we see the result of this in verse number 7. And the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we look at part number 2, how to experience the peace of God in your life. Father, we come tonight and ask Your blessings upon us as we study this Word. Teach us things that would help us to be more like Jesus, that would help us to live a less stressful life, a life that would be honoring unto You. And we pray that, God, You would fill us afresh and anew with Your precious Holy Spirit. Thank You for each one that came out this evening. Lord, I pray for those who are also watching by the means of Internet, maybe some in the parking lots, Lord, wherever they might be, I pray that, God, You'll take this message, use it for Your glory, in Jesus' name, amen. We asked the question this morning, is life really worth living?
Yes.
And to the unsaved person, many times they say no. They take their life. They say, no, I don't have any hope for the future. I'm just going to end it all. Yeah. Well, long ago, I heard about one of my childhood buddies who had taken his life. I would have never dreamed that he would have done that. He was the same age I was. We grew up together, played ball together, stayed overnight at each other's house. We were close buddies, but I hadn't seen him in years. And somebody told me that he overdosed. And I thought, well, that's so sad. So sad. And you just never know what people are having under their countenance. They may be really hurting on the inside. And so life is worth living when we have Christ as our Savior, and when we have the Lord as our God. Now, we finished up today, and we were looking here at, number one, if we're going to have peace in our life, we have to learn to be a peacemaker. A peacemaker.
Yeah.
As I mentioned, we all carry around 2 imaginary buckets, 1 with fire, 1 with water. We come upon a scene where people are upset, or people are fussing, or maybe there's some gossip going on, we can throw the water on it and put it out and say, I don't want to hear that. Don't talk about my friend. That we're children of God. We know better. Or we can throw fire on it and just spread it like wildfire, make it worse. So the best way to do it is just to be a peacemaker. I'm glad that Jesus came down, and He was a peacemaker between us and God the Father. And so now we follow His example. Praise, number 2, not only be a peacemaker, but rejoice in the Lord, and we see that in our passage in verse number 4. If you're going to experience the peace of God, learn to rejoice, not in the things that happen to you, because it might be something that doesn't happen that makes you upset. You don't put that as your joy maker. You rejoice in the Lord always. Praise ought to be the peace of our heart, and joy ought to be the breath of our lungs. And so there's so many things today that people rejoice in, but the most important person to rejoice in is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we know that for a fact. The most important person in our life is Christ. And as long as you have the Lord, then He works it out with everybody else in your life. He works it out every time. So as the Lord gives us strength, and as He gives us ability, and as He gives us wisdom, then we rejoice in the Lord. What does that word rejoice mean? It means to be full of cheer. It means to be happy, to be well off. And so we can have a cheerful countenance. We can be happy in our heart. We can have joy in our souls. Why? Because we've got a Savior who loved us, who died for us, who was buried for us. And now, thank God, He come back and He will indwell us. He'll go with us every step of the way. Do you feel that way this evening?
Yes.
Think about it. That word rejoice carries the idea to be cheerful, to be glad, Godspeed, greeting, joy. Are we joyful and happy? Do we have a sense of well-being? Do we really feel that way or not? If not, friends, come to the Lord. Come to the Lord and you will experience the joy that passes all understanding. You'll have the joy bells ringing in your heart. And so when you focus on the Lord and you have the joy of the Lord in your heart, then that means that you do it always. Go back to that verse, if you will, verse number 4. We're to rejoice in the Lord. How much? Always. Every situation. Woo! Thank God, I don't know how it's going to turn out, but I know God knows how it's going to turn out. I don't know what's going to happen, but thank God I know God knows what's going to happen. We do it for all things. Rejoice in the Lord always. Not just in the good times. Not just on the mountaintop. Not just when everything's bright and cheery. We rejoice in the Lord even in the bad times. We rejoice in the Lord even in the valley. We rejoice in the Lord even in those dark tunnels when it's low tide. Hey, high tide's going to come again. Amen. That's one thing I've noticed going down to the coast. It might be low tide now, but watch out. That water's coming back in.
Yeah.
And it might be low tide in your life tonight, but watch out. The high tide's coming again. He's going to bless you, and you'll have those joy bells again. So when should we focus on the Lord and have the joy of the Lord in our hearts? Always. Always. In every situation. That means every day we keep our focus on God. We allow Him to have His way in our life. And the result of that is that He will give us a sense of well-being.
Yes.
He'll give us cheerfulness as we turn to God for our instruction, as we turn to God for our help. In every situation, He will help us. Yes. Then in verse number 5, He said, "Let your moderation be known unto all men." Why? The Lord is at hand. The Lord is at hand. Now, what does that word moderation mean? That's a big word. Carries the idea appropriate. Carries the idea gentle. Moderation. Patient. Mild. So our manner of life needs to reflect the joy of the Lord by being gentle. By being patient. Even humble to the point that we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God.
Yes.
Meekness is involved in this. Somebody who is meek, they have strength, but it's under control. Sometimes we get the idea, if a person is meek, they're weak. That's not true. I mean, I heard about a woman, she's talking to her husband. She said, "Are you a man? Now squeak up and tell me, amen." Well, he wasn't a mouse, he's a man. But anyway, we're to be gentle. We're to be fair-minded, charitable to those inside and those outside of the church. Not just to fellow believers. This means that we're not to seek revenge against those who treat us unfairly. And neither are we to be overly vocal about our personal rights. Boy, everybody thinks I got a right for this, and I got a right for that, and it's just my rights. And I don't have any rights. He has the right to everything,
amen.
And our Savior's the one that paid the penalty. So our manner of life ought to reflect the joy of the Lord by being gentle and patient and humble unto the mighty hand of God.
Yes.
We could say that we're to focus on the Lord for a sense of well-being and happiness. And when you do that, friends, it produces a mild, gentle, patient lifestyle because the Lord is at hand
meaning he could come back at any moment. Praise God. Hallelujah. Woo! He's coming again, friends. He may be here tonight. Ultimate joy comes from Christ dwelling in us. Christ is near. And at the second coming, we'll fully realize this ultimate joy. He who lives within us will fulfill his final purposes for us. Why? Because we are his and he is ours. And thank God we're born again into the family of God. And we can't lose it. If we could, it would be over with. But thank God we can't lose it. It's too strong. God has us in the palm of his hand.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Number one, be a peacemaker. Number two, rejoice in the Lord. Number three, learn to pray about everything. Learn to pray about everything. Now we see that in verse number six. Notice in your Bible in verse number six, there's several different elements of prayer here. Be careful for nothing. Say it there, don't worry about a thing. But in everything, not just some things or the bad thing, even the good things. It said in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. We're to be careful for nothing, which means don't worry about it. Instead of worrying, learn to pray. And when you pray about a situation, instead of worrying about a situation, what's going to happen? I'll tell you what's going to happen. The peace of God is going to flood your soul, and you're going to look up to God and say, glory, hallelujah, Lord, thank you. You've seen me. You know what I'm going through. And God, you're going to take care of this situation. God's joy and God's strength is our power. And we're to pray about everything, big decision, small decision. There's nothing too hard for our God. Fret and worry indicate a lack of trust in God's wisdom. If we're going around biting our nails and scared to death and worried and fretting, we better take a checkup and see where our faith is. Our faith is not in us. Our faith is not in our ability to handle that situation. Our faith is in God. We just go forward and let him take care of it. Delight in the Lord and meditate in his word. And that's a great antidote to anxiety. The life worth living doesn't include worry. You may worry so foolishly that you pull tomorrow's clouds over today's sunshine. We worry about tomorrow when it hadn't even come yet. Well, I'm worried about Friday. Or I'm worried about Wednesday. What's going to happen? I don't know. Thursday looks like it's going to be just as bad. And all of these things happen in our life. And we just need to take it one day at a time and say, this is Sunday. This is the Lord's day. We're in the Lord's house. There's no better place to be than in the Lord's house. Woo! Thank God. I'm just going to enjoy the blessings of God and let him open the windows of heaven to me. Amen. Life worth living doesn't include worry. Of a Michigan study on worry, they determined that 60% of our worries are totally unwarranted. That's over half of them. Never happen. And then 20% are completely out of our control. There's nothing we can do about it. Or they're already behind us and we keep bringing it up. And the past can't hurt you unless you let it. And then when you go on, 1% is so petty that it makes no difference. So the remaining 10% of our worries, only 2% are real, and they can be solved with appropriate action with God. 2% out of what we worry about is legitimate. Almost everybody here, if we would be honest, we worry about this and we worry about that, and it destroys our peace and our happiness today. Hey, just thank God we've got today. And when tomorrow comes, it'll be today. That's why I like to tell Wanda, when you going to mow the grass tomorrow? Tomorrow comes. She said, I thought you were going to mow the grass. I said, no, tomorrow's when I'm going to mow the grass. This is today, amen. Heard about two friends. They stopped on the street to chat. One man said, hey, I heard you've been going to a psychiatrist. Has he helped you any at all? The other man said, he surely has. I used to be deathly afraid to answer the telephone. He said, now I answer it whether it rings or not, amen. I don't know what good that would do, huh? There are several ingredients in prayer that's mentioned in this one verse. We're going to look at them briefly and finish it up. Number one, first of all, the word prayer is mentioned. So go back, if you will, and look at verse number 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer. Now that word carries the idea to pray earnestly. Pray mightily. Yeah. Get down to business with God. Pour your heart out to the Lord. Sometimes tears will come out of your eyes. Sometimes you just have to come to the Lord. Your heart is broken, and you pray with all the power and strength that you have. You're going to get a hold of a mighty God in heaven, and with God, He will change that situation for the good. This carries the idea that prayer should also involve worshiping God. The word prayer carries the idea not just to pray about something, but to worship God. Worship Him in spirit and in truth. When we're in prayer, we're worshiping God. We're praying earnestly and sincerely and intently. And friends, stop and think about the great privilege that we all have. We have the privilege to pray to the King of the universe and the one that created the heaven and the earth in 6 days and rested on the seventh day. Woo! Glory! Hallelujah! That's enough to make a Baptist shout, amen. What a privilege that we have to go to the Lord and pray and worship and just praise His holy name. Jesus, You are wonderful. Jesus, I just want to stop a moment and thank You for how good You've been to. Next, we see the word supplication. Notice here it says not only by prayer, which means intense prayer and worship, but then He talks about supplication. Now, what does that word mean? Well, that carries the idea of petition. A petition. This is the area where we actually petition and ask God to do something. That is a part of prayer. That's not all of prayer. But that is a part of prayer. We've been worshiping God. We've been adoring His presence. But now we get down to learning that we need to pray and petition God about what's burdening our hearts and causing us to worry. It'll give you power. It'll give you strength when you learn to take that petition and turn it over to God and let God take that petition in His heart and in His well-being and answer that request for you. You know, God can even take a bad thing and turn around something that's good. All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose in Christ Jesus. Have you noticed that worry will consume you if you let it? I mean, it'll sap the strength out of you. You won't feel good. You'll be ill and upset and worried to death. It hinders your joy. Stops you from being happy. Learn to go to God and petition God and ask God for help and guidance, and He will come through when you need Him. He's always there. His line's open 24 hours a day. Then there's another part of prayer. We alluded to it a while ago. Not only prayer, supplication, but notice, with thanksgiving. How many times have we prayed for something? God answered our prayer. We said, thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. But then we forgot all about it. Oh, friends, I think we ought to thank Him and thank Him every day for our salvation. Thank Him every day for our church. Thank Him every day for our family, our country. Thank Him every day for all that He's done for us. The blessings of God come down upon us. Let's not be guilty of being thankful. Attitude of gratitude is the greatest attitude in the world, friend. And when we're grateful, it means a lot. Thanksgiving is giving God thanks for all of His blessings upon us. In the Greek language, it's noteworthy. Here's what thanksgiving means. Gratitude. Actual grateful language to God in an act of worship. Thankfulness of heart. Giving thanks to the Lord. So we're to have that attitude of gratitude. We're to use that grateful language, worshiping our God as we pray. When was the last time that you stopped long enough just to take a pencil and a piece of paper and just list out all the good things God's done for you? You may be having a bad day, but get you a pencil and a piece of paper. Start writing those things down, and pretty soon you're going to say, boy, He sure has been good to me. I forgot about that. Oh, yes. When you start thanking God for His continual blessing, the peace is going to flood your soul like a sentry guard. Notice the result of learning to pray about everything. It says in verse number 7, And the peace of God that passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I mean, the peace of God's going to guard you. Going to guard you against stress and worry and apprehension. You'll have a peace that cannot be understood by the natural person. They say, what in the world is he or she so happy about? They're going through all kinds of trouble. Hey, it's not what we're going through, it's what's happening inside of us that counts. And God is using whatever we're going through to make us strong in our faith in God. We got a peace that the natural world doesn't understand, but with God, all things are possible. Now, what does that word peace actually mean? Here's the idea of prosperity. Peace and quietness, to be at rest again. Isn't that what we need?
Yes.
To be at rest, to be tranquil, to be in a position where we can just relax and say, I'm not the general manager of the universe anymore.
That's right.
I can't straighten this one out. God, it's yours. I'm just going to enjoy what you've got for me. Prosperity, quietness, and rest is the result of allowing the peace of God to flood our soul. And when the whole world is falling apart and it looks like you're at the end of the rope, you've got a quietness and a peace in your heart that cannot be understood from without. Why? Because we have that peace from God Almighty, and glory to God. That ought to make a Presbyterian shout amen.
Yes.
The word there in verse number 7, notice the word keep. The peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep. Underline that word, your hearts and minds, through Christ Jesus. That word carries the idea of a mounted guard. A guard that protects us, a garrison of soldiers. God's peace is like a sentinel guard looking after our well-being in the midst of the worst of circumstances. He will affect us by guarding us and protecting us and giving us that peace like a giant garrison sent from heaven. The God of heaven is helping us to avoid stress with peace and tranquility. Heard about a preacher. He told a story one time about a friend of his who was a GI over in France during World War II. And he was mopping the floor, and the floor was just covered with soap and water. And about the time he was mopping the floor, the bombs started falling on the building where he was mopping. That man tried to run on that slippery floor, and he couldn't make it an inch or two, and he'd fall down and get tangled up in his pail and his mop. Somehow he ended up underneath the stairs. He is struggling to get out of all of that mess, and the bombs are dropping ping pong everywhere. Here comes a bomb, there comes a bomb, and here's what he prayed. Oh God, if you'll just get me out of this mess, I'll get myself out of the next one. Amen. I want to say he's not going to be able to get himself out of the next one. It takes God to get us out of our mess. Friends, there's no big things. There's no little things for God. Every bit of it is within his reach. And do you have that peace that passes all understanding? If not, you can have it, number one, by being a peacemaker. Number two, by rejoicing in the goodness of God. Number three, learning to pray about everything. Come to the Lord. He'll give you victory over all the problems and the difficulties you face each day. And it starts at that old rugged cross where the Savior bled and died and rose again to save us. Because of our faith in Him, we can have peace. Do you need peace? Peace is not found in a bottle. It's not found in some immoral act. It's not found in all the thrills of the world. Peace is found in a person. And that person is none other than Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Maybe tonight you'd say, preacher, I need more peace in my life. I need his help. I need his strength. I've got a burden on my heart. I don't want it to rob me of my joy today. Pray for me. I'll be glad. To anyone like that, you'd slip a hand up all around the room. Hands are lifted everywhere. Father, you've seen our hands. It's just a reminder that, Lord, we know that we're weak and inadequate. But we know that you're fully able to give us joy in the present tense, today. And we let tomorrow be in your hands, Lord. We let the next day be in your hands. Let us enjoy today and just have a good time in the Lord, whatever we have. We give you the praise. Bless each one that raised a hand for whatever need. God, we know that you're able to meet it. We'll give you the praise for it. For it's in our Savior Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We'll stand our feet, heads are bowed, and eyes are closed. If you'd like to come down around the altar, we'll just have a silent invitation. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Christians are praying. Maybe you want to come down and just say, Lord, I need your touch tonight. I've got a burden on my heart. God, I've got to leave this in your hands. Lord, I need to learn to pray about everything. Because, God, I realize that it's too much for me, but it's not too much for you. You want to come and be saved, or maybe you want to come and join the church. Whatever God asks you to do, you feel free to come. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Christians are praying. Several come to the altar. Anybody else like to come, you feel free to come. A peace that passes all understanding. A joy that can only come from the Lord. And I thank God for those blessings upon us. How wonderful He is. How joyful He makes us. All because of the peace. You glad you have peace tonight? Let's give Him a big amen. Ready? Amen. Amen. Thank God for that. All right. Let's be dismissed in prayer. Randy, if you would, you dismiss us. After He does, tell somebody you love them. Good to see them. I hope you have a great week. Brother Randy.
Father in heaven, I thank you, Lord God, for this opportunity. Lord, just raise our hearts and minds, Lord, towards you. Lord, I pray that you just help us. Leave here, Father, and take you with us.
Amen. Yes.
Lord, just help us to grow.
Yes.
Think of you, Lord, each and every time, Father. We have an issue in our lives. Pray, Lord, that you just help us to pray without condition, Lord. Pray without ceasing. If we might see the answers coming to us, we know you answer every prayer. Father,
yes.
Rejoicing in you, Father, praise back to the next appointed time. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thanks so much.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing? Me too. Me too.
It's all I do. I've been a lot better than I've been on her.
Make it look at who we're
getting.
Yeah. You got to be. Hey, amen.
Yes.
Love you, Gary.